All right, everyone, welcome to part two. We just got done discussing discourse communities and analyzing mainly the Sierra Club's webpage through those six tenets of discourse communities. Maybe if there's one thing we learned, that is that over time, if you want power to change the world, probably can't do it alone. Letter to the editor, although it seems like it's very public and might change the world, probably doesn't really do much. You've got to have a people with you and a large network of people operating if you really want to do something. And that brings us to one major point of the public sphere. Usually people talk about power when they talk about the public sphere, who's got it and who doesn't, right? And certainly to get power, you need a network, a group of people, right? A discourse community. Now, one thing that is a difference between the public sphere or a public and a discourse community, you could analyze them and they might not even, you might not even think of them being in contact with other groups. But in the public sphere, we automatically imagine a public, which a public is, or a counter-public sometimes it's called, is basically a discourse community. But there's a lot more going on because we imagine that discourse community, which we'll call a public, as in contact, cooperating or competing with many, many other groups. Okay, and so we want to think of it that way. They're in contact, and that's going to change the way that they operate. It's going to change what they do, whether it's physical activities and protests or whether it's just writing itself, which is one of the main things we talk about in our course. All right, so if we want to do a real quick sort of pseudo-history theory that comes out of the Wikipedia page that you read, here's what we could break this down to. The reading was pretty dense, and you probably didn't see all these things in there, and it's hard to understand if it's too jargony. So use this video to give you these major points. You want to analyze things through this. And after college, of course, you'll want these things on your mind, too, when you're trying to, whether it's for social activist reasons or professional reasons, trying to build a network of people for something you believe in. Here, you might want to jot these down. I'm going to pause. You can pause the video for a minute. Here's A through F, and there's actually a few more. Right here. And so I'm not going to put this up online for you to just save. I'd rather have you copy these notes out when you write something down, you remember it better. So pause the video and you might want to jot these things down. All right, we'll go back here. So this idea of power, we'll take it from the top here. We're going to be right here. A public may have power through birthright, social class standing, their social capital, which is usually education and any wealth you have, the way that you can present yourself in public and win people over, these types of things. You know, when the public sphere started, it was because merchants wanted shipping rights against kings, and they didn't want to be taxed so much and all of this type of stuff. But right away, we see, well, those shipping merchants, they can own a ship. They can sail across the ocean or the sea. They must have a lot of money. And so right away, the public sphere is money talking, right? A lot of power through the position in society and through their wealth as well. So that's one thing to keep in mind. So if that's where we start, and the theorization of the public sphere didn't really happen until like the 1980s, where people started to say, wait a minute, historically, here's what's happened for democracies. When the power of kings was waning and the power of the people started, which is about, we'll say, the 18th century, this thing called the public sphere started too, where all these groups are talking and competing for power now that it's not just kings that have it. So here's what we found in the couple hundred years since. Here's two main issues. A public can form around identity. Usually we think of identity as race, gender, class, sexual orientation, and religion. It can be other things too. But here we might think of the Black Lives Matter movement. We think of that, well, that's, it's a public group. Certainly they want something. They got values and goals and motivations, and they want to shape the world in the way that they do. We can see all that stuff of a discourse community is true for them. But here's the big thing. If you're Black, are you automatically a member of Black Lives Matter? Or, you know, can you be white and a part of the group? Or is identity the best way to say or to predict membership in this group? Maybe, maybe not. It might be more of our second theory here, B, that it's around issues related to African Americans, in particular, Black Lives Matter was because of shootings, right, of African American males mostly. And so that's more of an issue. There are many African American issues that a community could talk about, and a very specific one launched Black Lives Matter, right? So is it identity or is it the issue? Well, it could be either one. I'm going to suggest that there's competing identities. And so one identity may win over another. And so we would expect, perhaps all African Americans be part of this group, but that might not necessarily be true. They may disagree because maybe they're a police officer and their identity as a police officer overrides sort of their commitment to the identity of being African American and belonging to this group, right? And so identities compete inside of us for our beliefs. We could see that too here if we think of gender, and this was in the reading Nancy Fraser is a sort of a feminist critic that you read. She had a lot to say about women being excluded from the original formulation of the public sphere, that only men participated and therefore only men had power. But women have power too, and then clearly now they get to participate more. Historically they haven't been able to, but still we can, this is interesting because if we say that, the fact that you're a woman is the major way that you'll identify with things in the public sphere, then that might not be true. Our example here might be the 2017 election and the Me Too movement and sexual harassment. Remember, a couple days before the election, this happened. Candidate Trump said had was caught on tape saying some pretty awful things that some people said could have been equated to sexual assault, right? And so those are some pretty heavy charges, but we know that he won the presidency anyway. And it turns out that he still won about two-thirds of all female voters without a high school degree. I'm not sure what it is with a college degree, I can't remember. But that means that despite the fact that all those women who voted for him probably don't think sexual harassment is good, their other identity, not as a woman, but as a conservative that votes Republican in America, seem to win out, right? I doubt that anybody thinks sexual harassment is good, especially women in particular. But still, that wasn't the dominant identity. So clearly, these, what we think of as the major identities, they don't always hold true, and they're not the ones that make us choose an identity or support an issue in the public sphere. They don't influence our actions as much as we think in some circumstances. There's plenty of other things we could talk about too. Religion is here. We can take very quickly a look at the pro-life page. See if I can find it here. One thing I was interested in when I looked at this page, you can take a peek if you want to, is I expected pro-life is usually connected to religious movements. And so I thought, great, there'll be a lot of religion here. The interesting thing I found is we can see everything that discourse communities have to offer. But we can also see that religion doesn't really appear here very much, at least not for a while. Eventually, we see a lot of facts actually about abortion. It's almost a scientific argument, which is kind of strange, you might think, for a group that has so many Christians, particularly fundamentalist Christians, inside of it. Usually, this is a group that sees science and religion as at war with each other to some degree, right? But there's a lot of scientific facts on the pro-life page. Eventually, you do start to see some of the religious discourse come in. National Day of Prayer, Christ is risen, right? So there are some telltale signs. They're sort of, we might say, throwing a bone to their what they see as their major constituency, the major members of their public, which are also Christian. But it's interesting if you think about why this might have happened this way. It's probably because they want to be seen as a secular movement so that they can draw on people that are not necessarily religious, and thus you have the scientific facts and sort of the disguising to some degree of religious rhetoric or religious membership or affiliations inside of the pro-life movement. So if you took a look through this, you would see everything here, and so I'll reference this a bit later, and you'd also see all the stuff of the discourse community. In many ways, this is almost a parallel to the Sierra Club page in terms of the way we could analyze what's going on for discourse community, etc. So we have that. So again, religious identity is kind of disguised inside of this larger secular identity, because maybe that's where power is. That's how you gain members, retain members, move outside of your primary identity and makes people join you, not because they're religious, but because of something else, right? And so we're drawn back to the issue. It's issue-based rather than being based in the identity, in this case of religion. All right. So if we want to talk about issues for a minute, I'll just sort of mention some. Environmentalism. So it doesn't really matter what you are when it comes to your identity, especially those mentioned here. You could still care about the environment or not. Right. School budget cuts. Again, people of any of these qualities could care deeply about school budget cuts, have opinions either way, or maybe not care about them at all. Right. Higher pay for Walmart workers, right, which is something that winds up on the front page of the news. You don't have to be just a Walmart worker to care. You might care anyway, and it probably wouldn't matter if you're any of these things, et cetera, right? And so you can see how that might work. So maybe it's based upon issue rather than identity. Right? Or maybe there are competing identities, as I mentioned earlier. So here's other things that these groups have. They all want to shape the world in some way. They have an ideology, a core set of beliefs. In fact, the very idea of a public suggests that they want to change the world, change the laws, customs, regulations, all of these type of things. We've seen that from the Sierra Club. We saw that from the pro-life page here that we just looked at. We even saw it to, if we wanted to say, the New York Times letter to the editor qualified as a sort of this invisible public. Well, it's in there too. So certainly these things are there. They're ideological, they're political, right? That's the world we are in the public sphere. It is a very political place, competing as much as cooperating. They may argue through traditional means, like logical argument. We saw that in the Sierra Club page on the honeybees, lots of facts and these types of things, lots of logic. But they can use subversive means as well. We'll come back to subversive means. Let's keep moving here so we can get through most of these. We'll likely use many genres depending on the situation. Again, if we want to think of Sierra Club, we can think of the narrative of the man traveling west and falling in love with things. We can think of the argument from the honeybees. Lots of visual stuff going on. If we want to take a look at the pro-life page here, we've got, this is really interesting. They're trying to be grassroots, what you can do in your own community, right? They're not just saying, just read us. They're saying, get out there and participate. Look at, here's their members, all have a red shirt. Sure, they have, maybe all talk the same and have the same values. They also look the same. They're marking themselves as a group. They're using common symbols, right? All of this type of thing. And so this is really, really interesting too, as a public in the way that they're defining themselves. But so they have common symbols, right? Visually, I guess what I was going to show you here is that this is a scene of action. Right, this is a scene of action, so it's a visual appeal. It's what we see first. They don't want us to read, they want us to associate with the visual appeal of this first. And so we see all of these things, sorry, we see all of these things going on in here. Oh, we could take a look at one more here. The sustainability page, again, if we look through, we've got narrative going on, we've got quick lists, 10 things you didn't know. Right, we've got some stuff that looks to be argumentative and factual in some ways. We've got some stuff that's inspirational, most likely. This is the goals. It looks more like a report. We've got stats down in the bottom here. We've got a video that summarizes all of this. So it's many, many different types of media. We've got this nifty little flow chart. This is pretty much everything you can have to make an argument, every type of evidence that you could provide to people. And it's all here, just available on this one page. Right? And so we can see that the many genres, depending on the situation, is true, right? May argue through non-traditional means. So here's one more thing I'll leave you with real quick. This is going to be from Culture Jammin', which is a fun thing to look at, as long as I can find it here. So now this would be social activism actually against somebody like Coca-Cola, and we can see some of it here. You can see these happen to be fast food ones that come up first, but culture jamming is when you take a sign or a symbol and you invert it in order to show the opposite meaning. And so you can see some of my favorites here are Murder King, should be Burger King, right? Probably showing that fast food is not that good for you, it takes years off of your life, right? Same thing with McDonald's, they've inverted the M to make a W for the weight gain that you might have from fast food. This one, the Coke, we all recognize Coke, but it's enjoy capitalism, getting at this idea that Coke is sort of going international, taking over the world, is only in it to make money. They don't do a lot of social good. That kind of clashes with the sustainability page. But Coke doesn't have a great history 20 or 30 years ago of expanding in ethical ways into other countries. They oftentimes, it seems, stole water from a lot of local geographies as they expanded internationally. And so that's where their sustainability movement actually comes from. So these are just a few examples of that. Another interesting one to look at is a magazine called Adbusters. I'll see if I have a moment to show it in the next video. We're about to run out of time here. So I think what I'll do is I'll end here. Here's the concepts we've talked about so far. And I'm going to provide just a short video of a few minutes to kind of wrap this up. So I'll see you for a quick part three in just a moment. All right, I will see you then.